Okay, the next item of business is a statement from Tom Arthur on the National Planning Framework. The Minister will take questions at the end of his statement, so there should be no interventions or interruptions, and I call on the Minister for around 10 minutes, Mr Arthur.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We have all been enthralled as the world has descended on Glasgow for COP26 to debate and commit to the future of our planet. The choices we all make now and in the years to come will define that future. Scotland must and will stand up and play its part and make the right choices that are in the public interest for us now and for future generations. The twin global climate and nature crises have focused many of our minds on the quality of our places. We know we have to change the way we plan our future places if we are to respond to these challenges. The coronavirus pandemic has also meant that we all have a much better understanding of our individual needs and our priorities. And whether we realise it or not, planning is central to helping us to recover and to deliver the Scotland we want to be. Planning can help us to deliver green energy, restore nature and create a circular economy. It can mean that we are protected from future threats of flooding and coastal vulnerability. And it can improve our health and quality of life by delivering homes that meet our lifetime needs, shops and services that we can get to easily, and local parks and outdoor spaces that improve our well-being. We must think today about the places we will need tomorrow, and we need to plan for that change. We will have to be more decisive and firmer about the development we do and do not want to see, to shape the kind of country we want Scotland to be. Presiding Officer, I am absolutely delighted that today the Scottish Government has laid in this Parliament Scotland 2045, a draft of Scotland's fourth national planning framework. This signals a turning point for planning. It is much more than a technical or routine update. It is this Parliament's opportunity to be clear about what's needed in shaping Scotland's future. It is our opportunity to lead the transition to stronger, greener, fairer, healthier communities across Scotland. The new National Planning Framework is part of a much wider planning reform programme, including this Parliament's passing of the Planning Scotland Act 2019. That Act has given the NPF a new enhanced status as part of the statutory development plan on which all planning decisions must be based. The 2019 Act also requires that development plans must work in the long-term public interest. That is what our draft NPF 4 does. Giving such a clear steer will enable Scotland's planning authorities to focus their local development plans on setting out a long-term vision for the future of their places. There will be no need to repeat planning policies over and over again, while retaining scope to tailor local policies to respect local circumstances. This will mean the planning system is more consistent and predictable, and that the precious time and resources of planning authorities can be deployed effectively towards supporting the delivery of good quality development. I must stress, though, that today is not the beginning for NPF4. Much has happened already to lead us to this ambitious new direction for planning. I want to pay tribute and say thank you to the many people and organisations from all over Scotland who have engaged enthusiastically with us before and during the pandemic. They have all helped to shape the draft we have presented today. Our engagement started at the beginning of 2020 with a call for ideas, backed up with an extensive programme of public consultation and involvement, including a Scotland-wide roadshow before the first lockdown. Over the last year, planning authorities have worked creatively with us to help to explore new duties to prepare regional spatial strategies. The outputs from this work have helped to shape the draft NPF4 National Spatial Strategy, and we can now open up the debate about the contribution of different parts of Scotland to a much wider audience. There have been extensive and detailed conversations about specific parts of the strategy, including the challenging question of housing numbers and the need to better support nature recovery. And we have received an enthusiastic response to our position statement, which we published last November. All of this work means that Draft Scotland 2045 is not just the Scottish Government's view of our future, but a collective effort to think about how we need to change. I want to see that collective effort continuing throughout the process of parliamentary scrutiny now ahead of us. We heard during the scrutiny of the 2019 Act how many members care a great deal about planning. This draft national planning framework aims to respond to many issues that many members have already told us are important. For example, we have listened to views from members that our planning system needs to do more to improve health and well-being. We have looked at how we can best mitigate and adapt to climate change. We are aiming to enable the repopulation of rural Scotland. We have set out how planning can improve biodiversity and protect peatlands. And we have brought forward a new approach to planning for housing that will support the delivery of new, good quality homes that meet all our needs. All of these issues and more featured during the parliamentary scrutiny of the Planning Bill and are now being addressed in this draft document. This draft National Planning Framework 4 brings together a new vision for planning, drawing on all we have heard so far, and it sets out a new spatial plan for Scotland in 2045. This is a plan which does not shy away from the sometimes uncomfortable choices we will need to make about our future. It sets out shared spatial planning principles and proposes 18 national developments that will help to deliver the strategy. It also proposes new and revised national planning policies which, once approved, can be consistently applied to development proposals across Scotland. In line with the work of Scotland's best-known town planner, Sir Patrick Geddes, our plan considers the importance of folk, work and place. We want to see livable places for people which better support health and well-being and are accessible to everyone. Productive places that help us to grow a well-being economy and deliver fair work. And distinctive places protecting our most cherished buildings and reinvigorating city and town centres. And all of this must lead to more sustainable places in line with our climate ambitions and our commitment to nature recovery. Now, I know it will take some time to get to grips with this draft framework and the transformational change it can lead. So to help with that today, I want to highlight some of the key changes we are proposing. A new policy will ensure that planners give significant weight to the global climate emergency in plans and decisions. Policies will also require us to consider how we adapt to the future impacts of climate change, including flood risk, infrastructure resilience, temperature change and coastal vulnerability. Development proposals will be required to contribute to nature recovery and community wealth building. We are proposing to update our policies on green energy and heat networks to enable the delivery of new facilities for a circular economy and to require more sustainable travel. We are promoting the rollout of 20-minute neighbourhoods so that people have to travel less and benefit from an infrastructure-first approach. This spatial strategy considers how this can work in practice, including how it will vary between rural and urban areas. New and updated policies proposing limiting greenfield development and out-of-town retail to ensure we protect the land we will need to reach net zero and to make the best use of vacant land and reuse empty buildings. All of this and much more in the draft NPF adds up to a more positive, greener future. A future where our places support people to realise their potential, rather than limiting opportunities and reinforcing inequality. People will no doubt have different views on the spatial strategy and draft policies. That is the nature of planning. But I hope we can keep in view these shared commitments, these shared outcomes, as we explore the detail over the coming months. Presiding Officer, the draft NPF4 will now be before this Parliament for a period of scrutiny lasting up to 120 days. I'm also pleased to announce that today we are kick-starting an extensive programme of engagement and public consultation running over a similar timeline. It is crucial that we hear from as wide a range of people in the consultation as possible so that their needs are at the heart of our plans for the future. Our people and our society deserve nothing less. I'm looking forward to having a wide-ranging, exciting and, yes, lively debate about the future development of Scotland to 2045, through Scotland's journey to net zero. But to conclude, I hope that all members will embrace this opportunity, that we can work together collectively to consider our draft with open minds and enthusiasm about what we really need from Scotland's planning system in the challenging years ahead.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr Arthur. The Minister will now take questions on the issues raised in his statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes for questions before we'll have to move on to the next item of business. It would be helpful if colleagues who wish to ask a question could press the request to speak buttons now or place an R in the chat function if they're joining us online. And I call first Douglas Lumsden.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and thank you to the Minister for advance sight of today's statement. And I refer members also to my register of interest, which shows I am still a councillor at Aberdeen City Council. With the National Planning Framework 4, partnership working will be vital, and a key partner in all of this will be local authorities and local planning authorities. One of the main pieces of work every local authority is focused on at the moment is the development of the local development plans. These plans are central to the economic and social development of our towns, villages and rural settings, and are heavily consulted on with local engagement and consultation events. So can the Minister comment on how local authorities have been consulted in the development of MPF4, what active engagement is currently ongoing with local authorities, and how is the Government ensuring that these plans, a year or more in the making, are workable within the new MPF4? And will the Government financially compensate any local authorities who have to restart their local development plans because of what's been covered today?
Minister.
Can I thank the member for his question? And he's absolutely right to recognise the fundamental importance of local planning authorities. The end has been the product of over 2 years of work, two rounds of consultation across portfolio work right across government. But consultation and engagement with local authorities has played a key role on, for example, housing numbers or the emerging indicative regional spatial strategies. Local authorities have been engaged every step of the way. Now, as a member will be aware, there are measures set out which will be set out regarding transitional arrangements for local development plans, but I would want to bring to the member's attention that he will be aware of the provisions of the Planning Act 2019 include provisions for new style local development plans. I will be laying draft regulations on the new style local development plans shortly. Another important issue, which I'm sure the member will be aware of, is the importance of ensuring our planning authorities are well resourced. And so I'm glad to confirm to the Minister that I will be laying regulations on fees towards the end of the year. Because ultimately, if we're to make this a reality, we need well-resourced planning authorities. And I'm committed to making sure that is the case. So we will work collaboratively, we will work constructively with local government, with planning authorities and with a whole range of stakeholders. And I would also draw the members' attention to the participation statement and which we published recently and the programme of engagement which we published today, which gives a view of how broader consultation would be. And I would take this opportunity as well to encourage members to engage in their own constituencies with their own local authorities thoroughly. I want as many voices as possible to participate in this consultation. This has to be something where we get collective buy-in, because it is going to be setting the journey for Scotland, the planning journey for Scotland to net zero 2045. So it's vital to ensure that broadest commitment and engagement possible.
Thank you. And Sarah Boyack.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and to the Minister for advance notice of his statement. I agree our priorities have to be COVID recovery and delivering on the climate and nature emergencies, but the key message from COP26 is that it's not enough to have the targets. You need the effective planning and funding for implementation. So can the Minister say what new resources will come through NPF4 to enable local authorities to deliver on the infrastructure, for example, to make floodplains safe for residents and to build an adaptation infrastructure for new investment mentioned in the paper, for example, the rapid transit networks and the high-speed rail mentioned in the document NPF4? And will the document rule out fracking proposals given the negative environmental and climate impacts?
Minister.
Thank you. I missed the last part of Sarah Boyack's question.
Fracking.
Yes, I hear that loud and clear. The member will be aware of the government's policy on unconventional oil and gas, and that remains unchanged. On the broader issue of resourcing, I already touched in terms of resourcing for planning authorities within my response to Mr Lumsden. On the delivery of the National Planning Framework 4, it's important to remember this is a draft document. We do have in Part 4 of the document delivering our spatial strategy, and when the finalised document is agreed, we will publish a fully worked-up delivery plan, which will be a live document and will be in partnership with other government strategies as well. I think the Chamber would think presumptuous of me if I published a fully worked-up delivery plan at this particular juncture, but that will help to address a lot of the points that Ms Boyack raised. And of course, what is ultimately reflected in the final NPF4, as I hope will be agreed by Parliament prior to summer recess, will be the product of a consultation and engagement which is beginning right now.
I call Joe Fitzpatrick, who joins us remotely, will be followed by Tess White.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. With many new build housing developments poorly served by bus services and safe segregated cycle paths, what assurances can the Minister provide that the NPF4 will ensure the future housing developments in Dundee and elsewhere are well served by sustainable transport options so that people can walk, wheel, cycle or use public transport to access schools, shops and other local services?
Minister.
Can I thank the member for that question? It's an important question. There's policy specifically on quality housing, which take account of place. There's also policy on sustainable travel, sustainable transport as well within the document. And of course, there is the national wheeling and cycling and walking network as well, which is a national development which touch upon all of these particular issues that the member referred to. I think more importantly and fundamentally is the concept of 20-minute neighbourhoods, and this is something that is embedded throughout draft NPF4. We are strongly promoting local livability, directing future development to existing city, town and neighbourhood centres, and supporting sustainable rural communities. The draft NPF4 very clearly advocates limiting out-of-town and greenfield development and making much better use of vacant and derelict land and empty buildings. This will greatly enhance our existing places and communities, and this focus on well-planned, good quality homes will bring many benefits for our environment, communities, health and our lifestyles. And also it will disincentivise unsustainable travel and in doing so incentivise sustainable travel.
Thank you. Tess White, to be followed by Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Does the Minister recognise the importance of working with commercial partners as part of the transition to greener, fairer, healthier communities in Scotland, such as the partnership between BP and Aberdeen City Council on the low-carbon hydrogen energy hub, which is opposed by the Scottish Government's Green Coalition partners?
Minister.
I would, in responding to the member, I want to approach this in an open, constructive and engaging spirit. And I think we all recognise that reaching net zero is going to be a collective and collaborative effort. Government has a role, the private sector has a role, communities have a role to play as well. This is the start of a long period of consultation, and I would encourage the member to engage with that process constructively. But we are committed to working in partnership to deliver net zero, and it's a constructive process of engagement and partnership that I will certainly be leading on and taking forward the consultation of this document.
Audrey Nicholl, to be followed by Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I draw members' attention to my register of interests. I'm also a councillor in Aberdeen City Council. I'm pleased to see that Aberdeen Harbour is one of the proposed national developments included in the draft NPF4. Can the Minister outline what role the Scottish Government envisages the harbour will play in the transition to net zero and stimulating economic interest, investment in the North East?
Minister.
Can I thank Audrey Nicholl for her question? Our spatial strategy is clear that Aberdeen Harbour and the North East of Scotland will play a crucial role in our transition to net zero. NPF4 identifies the ongoing redevelopment of Aberdeen Harbour as a national development, carrying forward an existing national development from NPF3. The draft NPF4 does not, however, cut across ongoing consideration of a local development plan, which is addressing wider land use proposals arising from the energy transition zone.
Thank you. Colin Smith, to be followed by Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. NPF3 had a commitment to town centre first, but I'm sure the Minister will accept that the decline of our high streets has continued, in fact, sadly accelerated in recent years. So does he accept that whatever the commitments made in NPF4 on town centres, which you referred to in his statement, they must be backed up by adequate resources? For example, building housing on a brownfield site to get people back living in their town centres is more expensive than putting a square box on a greenfield site. So will those extra costs be reflected in government grants, and will they be set up clearly in the delivery plan that he publishes?
Minister.
Member raises an important point. I would refer him to policies 25, 26 and 27 in distinctive places in city, town, commercial and local centres. That sets out the planning aspect. The member will be aware we have a commitment of £350 million over the course of this Parliament to our place-based investment programme. We will be taking forward a review of development obligations as well. Again, we'll be looking towards how we can implement the infrastructure levy provisions within the Planning Act. And further down the line, we'll be also looking at the issue of compulsory purchase order and reforming act to bring it up to date. There's a number of different components that have to come together to make sure we have all the levers at our disposal to see that regeneration and revitalisation of our town and city centres that the member referred to.
Jim Fairley, to be followed by Willie Rennie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As part of the moment organised by the Scottish Children's Parliament, I recently met online with pupils from Forgandenmy Primary School in my constituents of Perthshire South and Kinrossia. And one of the issues we talked about was using sheep's wool as building insulation. Wool is abundant, it's continuously renewable and it's locally produced. It lasts for decades and at the end of its life can simply be composted. Can the Cabinet Secretary tell us how NPF4 will ensure that new building standards promote the use of such sustainable materials?
Minister.
Can I thank the member for bringing this matter to the attention of the Parliament, ensuring that young voices are being heard in the Parliament as well. I would just note that we want our places and our buildings to be resource efficient. That is reflected within the draft framework as it promotes sustainable building, prioritising the reduction and reuse of materials, something that's intrinsically important towards achieving a circular economy. With reference to building standards regulations, mandatory requirements such as the need to limit heat loss from buildings are set on a performance basis. Regulations and supporting guidance define an expected level of performance, but do not prescribe the use of any particular material or solution when demonstrating compliance with standards.
Thank you. Willie Rennie, to be followed by Fergus Ewing.
Right now, homes with gas boilers have been built in my constituency, and Persimmon Homes have refused to connect new homes in Garbridge to the already operational district heating system 100 metres away. Will the new significant weight for the climate emergency in the framework prevent these kind of decisions in future?
Minister.
The member will obviously appreciate that I cannot comment on any individual and specific case, but when he has a chance to look through the document, he will see strong commitments to supporting heat networks and, in general terms, the matters that he raises. So I would encourage him to look through the document and he will hopefully find the answer he's looking for.
Fergus Ewing, who joins us remotely, to be followed by Anne-Ann Burgess.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. May I ask if the Minister can provide reassurance to me and my constituents in Inverness and Nairn that this statement does not and will not in any way, manner or means delay, detract, diminish or dilute the absolute commitment of this Scottish Government to dual the remaining sections of the A9 between Perth and Inverness and the section of the A96 from Inverness to Aldern, and to do so as swiftly as possible?
Minister.
Can I thank the member for his question and his, as always, formidable and robust defence of his constituents' interests. As Mr Ewing will appreciate, NPF4, this is a draft document. We hope to have it adopted by Parliament prior to summer recess, so it is forward-looking and will consider future planning decisions. More generally, the sustainable transport hierarchy from NTS2 applies in rural areas as well as urban. Draft NPF4 proposes that both rural and urban areas demonstrate how they provide for and prioritise transports in line with the NTS2 hierarchies. Government policy aims to reduce car kilometres by 20% by 2030. This is needed to meet ambitious carbon reduction targets in the face of a climate emergency. Draft NPF4 aims to provide...
Excuse me, Minister. There's a bit too much chuntering from a sedentary position. Continue, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Just to conclude, draft NPF4 aims to plan future development in a way that helps us to achieve zero carbon living. It looks to minimise the need to travel by unsustainable modes, for example, through the creation of 20-minute neighbourhoods, where these are achievable. However, there will be those who continue to rely on a car, and NPF4 aims to support the rollout of electric vehicle infrastructure, which is, I'm sure, something Fergus Ewing will warmly welcome.
Ariane Burgess, to be followed by Stephen Kerr.
I thank the Minister for an advance copy of his statement. The new national planning framework demonstrates an important shift towards a plan-led system that helps communities and nature thrive whilst aligning with Scotland's climate targets. This shows the value of Greens in government. It paves the way for a massive expansion in renewable energy and active travel, as well as channelling the £55 million nature restoration funding announced on Saturday. I particularly welcome this shift in focus towards communities, 20-minute neighbourhoods and town centres that will work for people, not traffic jams. What insurance can the Minister provide that the huge ambition and scale in tripling the budget for walking and cycling to at least £320 million, or 10% of the total transport budget, will not just be focused on the Central Belt, but will benefit communities across Scotland?
Minister.
Question, if you appreciate it, it's not for me, perhaps, not being Transport Minister, to comment on these specific matters, but this is a national planning framework, so it applies to all of Scotland, and I can assure the member that it will apply to all of Scotland in the fullest way. And a key aspect of that is recognising that certain commitments and certain policies will apply differently depending on locality, an obvious one being 20-minute neighbourhoods. In urban centres where we have high population density, a 20-minute neighbourhood will be quite different than a 20-minute neighbourhood might be in one of our more rural or island communities. And that is, again, one of the areas we're very keen to hear response and feedback on through this consultation process. So I would encourage the member to respond to the consultation and to encourage all of the stakeholders that she engages with to respond to the consultation.
Stephen Kerr, to be followed by Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. When a minister doesn't want to answer a question, he simply reverts to reading his civil service briefing. So I think we've had an object lesson in that from the minister today. But this statement is lots of buzzwords, it's lots of fuzzy ideas. It's pretty much what we've come to expect from the SNP government, frankly. And the minister is fair enough and frank enough to admit that we're years away from action. So will the minister say what the government is going to do now in respect to town centres, many of which are in need of urgent action, and not just words, not just buzzwords, especially after the last 18 months, in which have resulted in shop vacancies being at a six-year high? And what will this statement do now to convert derelict and abandoned brownfield sites into usable spaces?
Minister.
How much time do I have, Presiding Officer? I will keep this terse, and I am not going to get drawn into a political bun fight, because this is a positive day for planning. And I hope the member will reflect upon his comments, because this is not just the result of the work of government. There has been a huge process of engagement with the planning profession and stakeholders right across Scotland. And I would just encourage the member to take the time to digest this document, to fully consider it before coming to any hasty conclusions. Because the document also reflects the provisions of the Planning Act 2019, which I appreciate he wasn't in this place when it was passed, but it was something that his party supported and indeed worked on and engaged on constructively. So I would just encourage a member to fully digest the document. Specifically on matters around town centre, I already referred to the £350 million of the place-based investment programme. We have the Fight Five of the Scotland Loves Local campaign. We have the Scotland Loves Local Fund. We have the Scotland Loves Local gift cards. And I also will very soon be publishing a retail strategy, retail being a key action in our town centres. So there's a range of the work that the government's undertaking now. But in case it escaped the member's attention, this is about Scotland's national planning framework. This is a long-term strategic document until 2045. And I think if you approach it with that broader perspective, you will find a lot in it that you can agree with.
Thank you. And I call Emma Roddick, who again joins us remotely.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Could the Minister advise, in light of the focus on sustainability and tackling climate change within this draft, whether due consideration is being given to supporting suitable renewable energy developments, which will ensure the case for an interconnector for Orkney?
Minister.
I thank the member for her question. As she will appreciate, I cannot comment on any live planning applications. However, the Spatial Strategy recognises the exceptional opportunities for our islands and coasts in transitioning to net zero, supporting development which contributes to the blue economy and energy innovation and investment is an important part of this. The draft NPF4 also proposes an updated national development which would establish a need for strategic renewable energy generation and grid connections throughout Scotland.
And a very brief supplementary there from Jamie Huckle-Johnson.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. I very much enjoyed the Minister's response to Fergus Ewing and also Fergus Ewing's deadpan face as he didn't receive an answer. So can I ask the Minister again, will the A9 and will the A96 be dualled in full as planned?
Minister.
There is no change to the government's policy.
And that concludes this item of business. We will move shortly to the next item of business. I will allow a little time for front benches to take their positions.